Paul. The book of 1 Corinthians chapter 12, please. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. I'm going to read this evening from the NIV. We're continuing with our series on spiritual gifts. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. I'm sure by now you have become quite familiarized with this text, but we will read it again. Amen. Verse 1. I would ask you to stand to your feet for a moment, please. Please stand with me for a moment in the reading of God's word and honoring his word. Paul, writing to the Corinthians, he says, "But about spiritual gifts, brothers, I do not want you to be ignorant." I do not want you to be ignorant. Let's pray. Father, in Jesus' name, I pray for your divine anointing, your strength. Father, I pray that you prepare the hearts of your people even now to receive the word of God, and Father, to activate and stimulate the very gift of God that is in them, each one of them. Father, right now we ask for the assistance of the Holy Ghost, and we ask you to anoint your word, Father. We ask you all this in Jesus' name, amen and amen. Give the Lord a praise offering as we find a place. God bless you. You may be seated, amen. 3 weeks we've been at this now, at this series entitled Spiritual Gifts. It's a four-part series that we will conclude next Wednesday. But we started it out laying out some foundational truths. The first things we spoke about, if I may, for a few moments to refresh your memory, we talked about the fact that every believer has a spiritual gift. That the day that you gave your life to Jesus Christ, God gave you a spiritual gift. We also spoke about the fact that spiritual gifts should be passionately pursued by every believer. Unfortunately, that is never the case, or most of the time, it's not the case. We normally don't think much about our spiritual gifts, yet the Bible clearly instructs us, and according to Corinthians, that we ought to pursue spiritual gifts with a passion. We also cover the fact that although spiritual gifts are freely given by the Holy Spirit, it is our responsibility for their development. Spiritual gifts are developed. We spoke about the fact that spiritual gifts are never a measurement of character. That means that you may have the gift of preaching, but you may have a horrible character. You may have the gift of prophecy, but you got struggles with your attitude. Well, I want to say something to you, that your character is something completely different to your spiritual gifts. When God gave us spiritual gifts, he never took our character into consideration. That does not excuse us. That does not excuse us from working on our character. It simply means that when God gave us a spiritual gift, he did not take our character into account. This is why in the church, many times you have people who are greatly gifted but have terrible attitudes. How many ever seen that? Amen, in a church. Well, that's all right. God's working with those people as they are developing their gifts. Another thing we touched on is that mirroring or copying someone else's gift will only incarcerate the expression of your own gift. You and I need to be who God created us to be. I don't need to be like the preacher out on the radio. You don't need to be like the prophet, amen, going out to some radio station. You need to be who you are and who God created you and gifted you to be, and you need to be happy with that, amen. We also covered the fact that the effectiveness of our gifts is measured only by those it helps. Meaning, you may be very gifted, but if your gift is not helping anybody, then your gift, quite frankly, is worthless. Our gift ought to help the body of Christ. Amen. This evening, I believe that God has gifted me with the gift of preaching and teaching. Well, the whole purpose behind that is to help and to edify the body of Christ. I don't know what your gift gift is, but whatever your gift is, it needs to be used for edification and building up one another in the body of Christ and not tearing each other down.
Amen.
Yeah. Hallelujah. And then lastly, we talked about the fact that to lose sight of the motive for our gift is to render our expression of the gift worthless and meaningless. Paul, in his letter to the Corinthians, he said this: if I speak with tongues of men and angels and do not have love, I am nothing more than a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. He says, if I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge and have faith that can move mountains, but I do not have love, he says, I am nothing. He says, if I give all that I possess to the poor and give my body over to hardship and to be burned, he says, but I do not have love, he said, it profits me or I gain nothing. What Paul is saying is this, that our gifts, even though they may be important, if they are not helping your neighbor, your brother, and your sister, then your gift is worthless. It's what we covered in the first session. Last week we spoke about four different gifts: the gift of message of wisdom, the gift of message of knowledge, the gift of faith, and we concluded with the gift of healings. This evening we are going to cover three more gifts that are in the church. Now there may be people here this evening who have one of these, or you could have more than one. The first one we want to cover tonight is the gift of miraculous powers. Amen. Miraculous powers. If you go down to verse 10 of our text, it says, to another is given miraculous powers. Now, this is a gift in the church. There are people in the church, and I pray that I can inspire you this evening, that have the ability to perform miracles in the church. We're so far from this that sometimes we have trouble understanding what exactly that means. The King James renders it this way, quote, to another working of miracles. What is this gift? There's two words here that I want you to take note. Amen. If you're taking notes, write these words down: working and miracles. He says that in the church, there are some who have been given the gift of working miracles. The first word there, working, is the Greek energema. Energema, and it means operation. It comes from a root word, energio, which means an effect, as you would have a cause and effect. And it simply means the results or the effects of the energy of God in the believer. So when it says the workings of miracles, that word working in essence simply means the effects or the result of the energy of God working inside the believer. When you came to Christ, there was a working, an inner working inside of you. This is why some of you who drank booze all your life, when you came to Jesus, you no longer had a taste for booze because there was an inner working inside of you. This is, amen, that's all right, glory to God. This is why some of you who were hooked on crack cocaine, hallelujah, when you came to Jesus Christ, there was something happening on the inside of you that you could no longer do the pipe anymore. Why? Because there was an inner working inside of you. This is a word that Paul used for the Philippians. When he writes to the Philippians in Philippians 2:13, he says, for it is God, get this please, it is God which worketh, same word, energio, it is God that works, energizes you, amen, by his grace, so that you will do both to will and to do his good pleasure. What is Paul saying? saying? He's saying that when I came to Christ, it's no longer by my strength. Something happened on the inside of me, bless God, that when the Holy Ghost came to live inside of me, something began to change. Amen. Something began to mobilize. And really what it was God energizing me on the inside to create something on the outside. That's why the Bible says it's not by your might or by your power, but it's by my spirit, says the Lord. And then you can try to get free, and you'll find yourself running into the same wall. You can try to break the drug habit, but you'll find yourself going back to the connection. Oh, but when Jesus comes into your life, and you get filled with the Holy Ghost, something begins to stir, something begins to move. Now, you don't want to be in the drug house, you want to be in the church of God. Amen. An energy. There is an energy working on the inside of you. That's the power of God. Amen. So he says, to one he gave them miraculous or working energio miracles. Working of miracles. This is another word that I want you to take note of. The word miracles is the Greek dunamis. And it really means power, strength, might, or miraculous power. It comes from a root word that means enablement, to be enabled. Paul used this word when describing the death and resurrection of our bodies. I want you to know that we're all going to die one day, but one day we will be resurrected. He used this word, dunamis, when he described our death and resurrection of our bodies. In 1 Corinthians 15:43, he said concerning our bodies, it is sown in dishonor, it is raised in glory, it is sown in weakness, it is raised in power, dunamis, might, strength, enablement, and miraculous power. What is Paul saying? That when we die, amen, we're going to die weak, but when God resurrects us, we're going to resurrect and dunamis, miracle working power. Amen. I'm going to get a brand new body. Amen. I'm going to get a real six pack. Glory to God. Amen. I'm going to flex before the Lord. Amen. I'm going to look good. Hallelujah. Why? Because when God comes to resurrect that dead body, amen, dunamis is going to get me. Glory to God. So if you're here tonight, if you're weak in your body, sick, fear not, brother, fear not, sister. The day is coming, and it will come when the dead in Christ will rise first, and then we which are alive will be caught up to meet the Lord in the air, and know we shall be with the Lord forever. Amen. And there'll be no more hangups, no more hard times. No more financials. This is the word that he's using. So in the church, there are some that God gave, amen, energio dunamis. Energio dunamis, miraculous workings. Now I thank God for what's coming. I thank God for the resurrection. But I need energio dunamio now. I need healing now. I need deliverance. I thank God what's going to happen when the trumpet is sound up yonder. But right now, I got to deal with me now. Amen. So I need deliverance right now. I need God to help me right now. I need to be free from dope right now. I need to break this habit right now. And the only way that's going to happen is there somebody in the church who has been gifted with an energio dunamis. Somebody in the church. So I don't have to wait till I get to heaven. It can happen now if you exercise the gift that God has given you of miraculous power. How does that work? You lay hands on somebody and you believe God, he's going to heal them. Amen. You lay hands on the sick and they will recover. Jesus said, amen, and these signs will accompany those that believe. In my name, they will cast out devils. In my name, they will speak to the sick. In my name, amen, they will trample upon serpents and scorpions. There are people in the church with this gift. So, in essence, what is this gift? Let me tell you in general what this gift, miraculous power, enabio dumio, means. It is a special, write this down if you're taking notes, it is a special energizing power and enablement that God gives to certain members of the church to do supernatural works that cannot be produced by natural means or explained by logic. I'm going to say this again because we're dealing with the gift of energio dumio. It is working of powers. It is a special energy. I hope this gets in your spirit. I hope you step out and you say, God, I want you to use me in this area of my life. I want to see people get delivered. It is, quote, a special energizing power and enablement that God gives to certain members of the church to do supernatural works that cannot be produced by natural means or explained by logic or scientists. The doctor said you had cancer. We saw it in the MRI. It was there. It was a big ball, man. It was growing. I don't know. Something that you go back to the doctor. Someone prayed for you. The doctor said, where is the cancer? It disappeared. How did that happen? I don't know. I went to church. Somebody laid hands on me. I fell in the spirit. Amen. I got healed. Energio dumio. Energio dumio. That's in the church. In the church, we see this interlaced from Genesis to Revelation. Moses turning water into blood, energio dumios. Joshua speaking to the sun and telling it and commanding the sun and the moon not to turn, not to go out. Energio dumios. Elijah, amen, shutting the heavens and said, you are not going to rain for 3.5 years. Amen. That is supernatural. That is energio dumios. You can see it in the New Testament. Jesus takes 5 loaves. 2 fish and feeds 5,000 people. And there you do me as. Amen. Peter, amen, declaring sudden death on Ananias and Sapphira who stole the offering. He says, the same people that took your husband are not going to carry you out. The wife falls dead and they carry her out. How? And there you do me as. It's in the church. And I dare say that the church has lost that gift. We have become so naturally minded, so logical in our thinking that we no longer step out and believe God, that God can still do miracles, that God can still heal a marriage, that God can still heal your children, that God can cause boils to fall off of you. He can cause cancers to fall off of you. Amen. That he can deliver you from headaches. Amen. And he can deliver you from tumors. Because God is still a miracle working. Folks, I need to tell you something. We need to believe God. I fear that we can say amen and not really believe it. God gives us this miraculous gifting to the church for one purpose, to strengthen and to edify the church. God don't want people walking into the church sick and leaving sick. God don't want marriages walking into the church in turmoil and leaving in turmoil. God don't want your home to be falling apart with when you walk into the church and when you walk out. That's why he gives that gift to the church, amen, so that people can be healed, delivered, set free, and restored, because Jesus came to give you life and life more abundantly. So I challenge you to believe God for that gift. To ask the Holy Spirit, Lord, that you give me that Holy Spirit, that you give me that gift. And if the Lord says yes, I would encourage you to step out and find somebody that's ill in the church and lay hands on them and begin to pray for them. Amen. Gift number two, give the Lord a praise offering. Gift number two, amen. The second gift that God gives to the church is the gift of prophecy. Verse 10, to another prophecy. Now, what is this gift? That word prophecy, in its foundational meaning, means prediction. So God gives the ability to members in the church to predict things. The word comes from two words and actually means two things when you speak about prophecy. It means foretelling or forthtelling. Foretelling or forthtelling. Let me tell you about the first one, foretelling. To foretell is to know the future. God gives people in the church, please don't lose it right here. God gives people in the church the ability to know the future. What do you mean by that? God gives people in the church the ability to know the future. He can do that through dreams. He can do that through visions. He can do that through flashes. Amen. Just a flash that you get. If you pay attention, God will begin to speak to you through flashes. God, now let me, I've got to lay some foundation in this thought. You are spirit. When God created you, he made you body, soul, and spirit. Deep on the inside of you, in the inner core, is your spirit man. It's what causes your body to animate. It's what brings life to you. On the outer layer of that, amen, is the soul. This is the mind, the thinking, the emotions, amen. This is where you get your anger, your frustration. All that comes from the soulish realm. Your spirit loves God. Your soul has issues. Amen. Come on, somebody. Your soul has some issues. You got issues. Sometimes, how many of you ever been in a place you want to worship God, but you feel down and depressed and discouraged and disappointed? Well, the disappointment, the discouragement comes from your soul. Amen. Your spirit wants to worship God. The inner man wants to worship God, but it's got to go through the soul, and then it's got to go through the body. And sometimes the body don't want to be here. The body wants to be at home watching television. Your spirit is saying, get to church, worship the Lord. Get to church, worship the Lord. The soul is saying, I'm tired. The body is saying, listen to the soul. And there's a battle. This is what Paul is saying, that inside of me, there's a raging battle. I want to do the good thing, but when I want to do the good, evil is present there, and it does not allow me to do the good thing. So your spirit is connected with God. And this is where all the frequencies come into. The frequencies do not come into your mind, because the Bible says, amen, that the natural mind is an enemy of God. It cannot know God, and it cannot receive God. So your natural mind is an enemy of God. But your spirit is a friend of God. Amen. So when God sends frequencies, they go into your spirit man. This is why if you're not in tune spiritually, you'll miss them. Now in the church, God has given the gift of prophecy, foretelling, which means to know the future. And if you're sensitive, you'll get this. Amen. In the book of Acts, there is a scene where an individual with the prophetic gift named Agabus moves in this gift. This is found in Acts 11:28. We can read this for you. It says, one of them named Agabus stood up and through the Spirit predicted, predicted that a severe famine would spread over the entire Roman world, and it happened during the reign of Claudius. Now what happened here? Agabus had a gift. Agabus saw something in the spirit. It was able, that person was able to bypass the soulish realm and the body, because the body is nothing more than the vehicle of expression. So Agabus saw something in the spirit. Agabus saw a famine, and that individual said, I see that God is about to bring a famine into the land. And it happened just like he said. It's a gift, a prophetic gift. And there are some of you here that have that gift. And that's a whole new preaching, and how to activate it, how to be sensitive to that. So prophecy is foretelling, but it's also forthtelling. When you got, listen, I'm going to step out here. When you have the gift of prophecy, you can speak things into existence by what you say. This is the gift of prophecy. You can declare things that are not as though they were. I was having dinner with my son the other day for his birthday, and he was telling me that there is this basketball player in the Lakers whose dad, he says, the kid would never have made it pro, but his dad, I think they call him B-ball something, triple B or something. He said, the dad, he says, the kids would never have made it, but the dad just begins to declare. He says, my kid's going to be in the Lakers. And some people laughed at him, and he kept saying it, my kids are going to be in the Lakers. He said, well, guess what? He said, other team wanted to draft the boy, and he says, no, my son will not go with your team because my son's going to the Lakers. And he kept prophesying, declaring it, and decreed it, and today that boy plays in the Lakers. Yeah. Now, I'm not speaking to you about... I'm not talking to you about positive thinking. That's completely new age. I'm talking to you that the Bible says, amen, that there are gifts in the church, that there are people that can not only tell the future, but they can actually speak the future into existence. They can speak reality into existence.
Hallelujah.
See, that's what you need in your marriage.
Yes.
You need someone with that gift to come into your marriage and says, sweetheart, I speak life into your marriage, amen. That's what we need. In the book of Acts, chapter 5, I've only got one more point after this, and I will release you this evening. In the book of Acts, chapter 5, verses 9 and 10, we find the story of Ananias and Sapphira. We know the story well. This is a couple in the midst of a revival. They had sold their home. And they presented themselves before the Apostle Peter. And they said, this is what we sold the house for. And they pocketed the rest of the money. They were lying to Peter. And the Bible says that Peter, amen, and under the power of the Holy Ghost, detected what they had done. And he said to, he began to prophesy unto Ananias. And he says, how dare you lie to the Holy Ghost? You did not lie to man. You lied to God. And now, amen, you're going to drop dead. And the minute Peter says that, bam, the man drops dead. Yeah. As they're carrying out the husband, the wife walks in. Listen, ladies. Don't ever side with your husband if they're wrong. Rebuke them and keep moving. Because sometimes, amen, your husband's wrong. You ought not to side with them. You need to stand individually before God, because God is going to judge us individually of what we did while we were on earth. Glory to God. So the wife walks in, and Peter asks her, what did you do with the money? He says, oh, we sold it for this much, when it was really this much. And the story picks up in chapter 5 of Acts, verses 9 and 10. I'll read it for you. This is the gift of prophecy working through Peter, the gift of causing future. Peter said to her, how could you conspire to test the Spirit of the Lord? Listen, the feet of the men who buried your husband are at the door, and they will carry you out also. He says, at that very moment, she fell down at his feet, and she died. What did he do? What he did was he foretold, amen. He spoke something into existence that wasn't there. Amen. This is a gift that's in the church. Now, I don't advise you, if you have the gift, to start killing people. Amen. Don't go around if somebody makes you mad, amen, and speak death unto them. The Bible speaks to us, amen. It says, in the tongue is the power of life and death, amen. So this is a gift. It's the same gift that Ezekiel used when God brings him to the valley of dry bones. It was a valley of dry bones, and God says, what do you see, Ezekiel? He says, I see dry bones. He says, speak to the bones and they will live. And the Bible says that Ezekiel began to speak, to foretell. He began to prophesy, amen, the gift of God, amen, without repentance. There's somebody here that might be saying to themselves, I have a gift, but I failed so badly. I blew it so badly that maybe God has taken back my gift. I want you to know something, brother, sister, that condemnation does not come from Christ. It comes from the devil himself, amen. When God gave you a gift, he knew that you would fail, and he knew that you would mess up, but I want you to know something, that what you need to do is take that gift and allow God to use you, allow God to move you, amen, and touch other people through that gift. Yeah. Hallelujah. Ezekiel goes to the valley of dry bones. He says, what do you see? I see nothing but dead bones. God says, prophesy. He begins to prophesy. Dead bones, you're going to live. And the Bible says the sinews begin to come and attach themselves to the dead bones. Amen. The muscles begin to attach themselves to this valley of a multiplicity of dead bones. And before you knew it, an army rose up, amen. An army of men. And what was God doing? He was showing Ezekiel that when you speak, hallelujah, you can cause things to happen that are not there, amen. That when you speak, you can cause things to happen that are not there. That's what the Bible teaches us to do. The gift of prophecy. The gift of prophecy. I have on my phone words and things that I have declared in the last 2 years. And I take notes of how many of them have come to pass. Some of you who work here today, you got good jobs, you got good jobs, and I'll tell you why. Don't think that it was your finesse and your expertise and your certificate. I pray for you that God would give you a good job, and I declared it and decreed it, amen, for some of you for over a year, and God bless you. Some of your marriages that are doing well, I want you to know why your marriage is doing well. It's not that I've got some supernatural power. It's that God gave us the ability to declare and decree and to change the atmosphere and to make things that are not as though they were. Isn't that what God did? When there was no light, he says, let there be light. Bam, and there was light. Hallelujah. When there was no moon, he says, let there be moon. Bam, and there was moon. Praise the Lord. Yep. When he saw man, and he said, man was lonely. Bam, he spoke, and the woman came into existence. That is the way that the Lord does things, folks. And that is a gift he's given the church. So if you're here tonight, you're in a situation that seems impossible to change. Get around people with the gift of prophecy. Amen. And tell them, prophesy. Prophesy over me. You ought to invite. That's why the Bible says, do not reject prophecy. Amen. Test the spirit, but do not reject it. Prophesy. Yes. Go into a marital problem. Amen. Go to someone with the gift of, would you prophesy over my marriage?
Yes.
Amen. Yes. Go through some financial hardship. Ask somebody, prophesy over my bank account.
Yes.
Amen. Can you believe it?
Hallelujah.
Can the church believe that?
Yes, hallelujah.
The last one I want to touch on, and I'll close with this one, is the gift of discerning spirits. Discerning spirits. Amen. Found in verse 10 of our text, to another distinguishing between spirits. The King James would render that discerning of spirits. What is this gift? First of all, I'm going to tell you what it's not. It is not a natural ability. It is a spiritual gift. It is not walking around with suspicion, cynical about other church members. Well, I got the gift of discerning spirits, brother. I can see something in your life ain't right. Now, be careful there. It is not being critical, a fault finder. I just feel in the Holy Ghost. And I see people do that all the time. Oh, I can feel that. Oh, I can feel that. There's some evil in that. No, come on. Amen. It's not fault finding. See, all these things, fault finding, being critical, suspicious, and cynical, that does not build the body, that destroys the body. And the gifts were given to build the body. So what is this gift of, as I close, of spiritual discernment? And I'll have to say this to you, that most pastors are gifted with this one. And there's reasons because of that. The gift of discerning spirits, quote, is this, is an extraordinary ability to discern the spirit by which things are done in the church. It's the ability to discern the spirit by which things are done in the church. Someone prophesies. It could be done in the Holy Ghost. It could be done in the human spirit. Or it can be done by an evil spirit. And I'm going to say something. Not everything that happens in the church is holy. Not everything that happens in the church comes from the Holy Ghost. Sometimes it's nothing but flesh. It's carnal. Amen. It comes from a human spirit. Amen. I remember we first started pioneering the church. Some young girl, I've shared this story with you before. Some young girl, we were in the middle of a Holy Ghost move. Amen. God was moving in the atmosphere. You can feel it was so thick you can cut it. Amen. God, people were weeping. People were slain on the ground. Amen. And then somebody gave a tongue. They began to prophesy. And we waited for the tongue to come, the interpretation. And this young girl stood up. And she says, "This is what the Lord says. Bring on the boogie." That's what she said. And everybody, amen, most people that were there that were not sensitive to the Holy Ghost, they began to clap. Oh, yeah, bring on the boogie. Glory to God. Bring. What is that? What does that mean? Bring on the boogie. Even some of the leaders were going, "Yeah, I can feel God. Yeah." They missed it. They weren't discerning. I knew right away, that's not God, that's not the Holy Ghost, that's not even an evil spirit, it's nothing but the flesh. Who knows what that little girl did before she came to church that night? Probably watching, amen, Saturday Night Live, amen, or that movie with John Travolta, Bring Out the Boogie, whatever it was, but it wasn't God. And you need in the church, you need somebody, amen, who knows how to discern spirits. You need that. So this gift, as I close, is an extraordinary ability to discern the spirit by which things are done in the church. Why is that important? Paul tells us the importance of this in 2 Corinthians 11:14. He says, "For Satan himself masquerades as an angel of light." Paul is saying, hang in there, David. Paul is saying that Satan comes into the church and he masquerades himself. He masks himself. And he appears to be an angel of light, but all along is Satan. But a person with discerning spirits can pick it up and say, "Oh, I know what you're talking about, brother. That ain't God. That's some evil spirit working through you." Amen. And a lot of folks won't pick that up. But the person with the gift will grab it. You find the clear example, beautiful example of this, my last text. In the book of Acts, chapter 16, verses 16 through 18. Read with me, please. I hope it's be above me. It says, "Once when we were going to the place of prayer, we were met by a female slave who had a spirit by which she predicted the future." Follow this. She earned a great deal of money for her owners by fortune telling. She followed Paul and the rest of us shouting. Now get this. This is a witch. This is a fortune teller. This is a tarot reader, a tarot card reader. She's following Paul, and this is what she's saying. She's saying, these men, meaning Paul and his companions, he said, these men are servants of the Most High God who are telling you the way to be saved. Question, is she saying the truth?
Yes.
Absolutely. She's saying, these guys know the way to salvation, and they did. She knew what she was saying. The Spirit knew what she was saying. And then she, now watch this, follow with me. Verse 18, she kept this up for many days. Imagine this, look over here for a moment. Imagine Paul and his apostles, his friends, they're walking around and you got this nuisance of lady. These men are servants of the Most High God. They're telling you how to be saved. Paul's trying to get somebody saved and she begins to shout again. These men, she goes on and on and on. And now look what happens next. She kept this doing many days, finally. Someone say, finally.
Finally.
You ever hit that boiling point? You ever hit that boiling point? Amen. Paul hit it. He said, finally, Paul became so annoyed. Stop right there. Do Christians get annoyed? Absolutely, yes. Sometimes we think that because we're Christians, we can't get annoyed. No, you can get annoyed. You can even be angry, but don't sin in your anger and your annoyance.
Amen.
It's your emotions. You have every right. God gave you those emotions. Finally, as I close, he said, Paul became so annoyed that he turned around and said to the Spirit. Now, who's he speaking to? The Spirit. Not the woman. See what we do? We address the person. We would have said, oh, you foul woman, you wicked woman, you terrible card reader, we attack the woman. He doesn't do that. He attacks the Spirit operating on behalf of the woman. He says, he's turned to the Spirit, in the name of Jesus Christ, I command you to come out of her. Now there's an exclamation point there. That means he didn't say like this, I command you, get out of here. Exclamation means there's some force in those words. I would dare say that Paul, come on somebody, when you're annoyed and you're irritated, in the name of Jesus, come out of her.
Amen.
When was the last time we cast some demons out of the church and the public square? Amen. This is what God called us to do. If we're going to have revival, if we're going to fill this place with 1,000 people, we got to move in the power of the Holy Ghost. Come out of her. Imagine that. At that moment, there's no exorcism going on. There's no holy water. En el nombre del Padre, del Hijo, del Espíritu Santo, sal fuera, sal fuera, fuera. There's none of that going on. They didn't call the local priest, amen. They didn't bring none of that, brother.
Hallelujah.
Paul didn't do none of that. He said, get out. And at that moment, when you're anointed, it happens, bam, at that moment. When you're not anointed, you got to exercise it out. When you're anointed, there is no exorcism. Le das una patada al diablo, bam, para afuera que se vaya. When you're anointed. At that moment, the Spirit left her. How did Paul know that that woman was talking through an evil spirit? How do you know that? Discerning of spirits. She was saying the right thing, but she was saying it through a wrong spirit. How many ever seen that in the church? This is a tremendous gift. And I do say that most pastors have this gift. This gift also includes please listen. The ability to know what motivates a man's heart. This gift has the ability to know what motivates a man's heart. What motivates his desires? What motivates his relationship with God? What motivates him for ministry? I want to be a pastor. I want to be a pastor. Pastor, I need to talk to you. I need to be a pastor. Why? Why do you want to be a pastor? Someone with the gift of discerning spirits will pick it up. Oh, I know why you want to be a pastor. You want recognition. You want people to call you pastor. Or maybe you just don't want to pay your tithes and you want to go open your own church. Well, let me help you with something. I've been a pastor 20 years and I still pay my tithes. Hallelujah. You can give Jesus better praise than that. Amen. Or maybe I want power so that I'm like, when I walk into the church, people carry my stuff. If you want to face the devil, be a pastor. If you want to face demons, just keep doing what you're doing. Martin Luther, the story is told. As you know, Martin Luther, not King, King. Martin Luther King was the one that ran from the cops and got beat up with a belly club. That ain't the guy I'm talking about. I'm talking about the reformer of the church. The story is told that one day he was laying in his bed. Now you have to understand something. If it wasn't for Martin Luther, we'd all still be Catholics. It was because of Martin Luther that he reformed the church. This is why he's called the reformer of the church. Because he says that we are saved by grace and not by works. So the devil really attacked that man. And one day he's laying asleep in his bed and he felt his bed move. He sat up in his bed and he testifies that he saw the devil himself sitting on the foot of his bed. I know that you think you've been fighting the devil. No, you haven't. Job fought the devil. Look at his outcome. You've been fighting a demon that's probably about this big. Amen. But I love when Christian says, how you doing, brother? Well, the devil's after me. No, the devil wants, listen, if the devil's after you, you're going to know it. So he sits up, Martin Luther. He looks at him and he says, oh, it's only you. And he lays back down and goes right back to sleep.
Hallelujah. Yes.
What are you saying, preacher? You got to check your motives. And why you're doing what you're doing, and why you want what you want. A man or a woman with discerning spirits, you can have a conversation with them and they know what's in your heart. They can tell. Oh, bless God, Pastor, I want to preach the gospel. I want to be a great preacher of the Word of God. Really, why, brother? Because I love God, and I want to see the Lord, and I want to see people get saved. Really? And he can look right in there and says, no, you lying sack of potatoes. This is not because of that. And he can find the real motivation behind all that. And listen, if your motives are wrong for doing that, you won't last.
Amen.
You won't last. Amen. Only those with the right motives can last.
Amen.
And last. And last. You see, a pastor doesn't have the luxury when his wife's angry with him to stay home. He still has to preach. A pastor doesn't have the luxury when the kids are acting up to say, well, I'm going to stay home. No, he's got to come. Got to keep coming and keep coming. Because his ministry is unto the Lord.
That's right. Hallelujah.
The gift. I leave you with one more text, can I?
Yes.
The gift of discerning spirits. Acts chapter 8, or some people would say it, Acts. Acts or ask, however you want to say it. I close with this. Acts 8, 17 through 20. Then Peter and John placed their hands. Watch this. Don't lose this. Peter and John placed their hands on them, and they received the Holy Ghost. When Simon, he was a sorcerer, when Simon saw that the Spirit was given at the laying of the apostles' hands, watch this, he offered them money, and he said to Peter, Peter, give me this ability also, so that everyone on whom I may lay my hands on could receive the Holy Ghost. Peter answered him, may your money perish with you, because you thought that you could buy the gift of God with money. What did Peter get? He knew this guy is hard and right. This guy wants ministry because of the money that is involved. He was going to sell the Holy Ghost for cheap. Peter picked it up. Discerning spirits. Discerning of spirits. Church, we have a vision to fill this room with 1,000 people. The only way it's going to happen, there has to be a supernatural move of God, and every one of us need to operate in our God-given gifts. You can start worship team. We must operate in our God-given gifts. It's tragic, but many people don't operate in their gifts. I've often said that I've never considered myself to be very gifted. But the one thing I have is that I'll pursue it until God says no. I'll pursue the gift of miracles until He says no. I'll pursue the gift of laying on hands and seeing people help until He says no. What is your gift? What is your gift? Are you sitting on it? I want you to stand with me. Stand to your feet, please. If you're not certain what your gift is, Paul said, listen close, this is what Paul said. He said, stir up the gift of God that is in you through the laying of the hands. And I know this has to do with the Holy Ghost, but tonight I want to do that. You're not sure what your gift is. I want you to come. And I'm going to pray over you. And I'm going to pray and you're going to stir. I'll pray, you stir it up. You're here tonight. You're not sure what your gift is. Get out of your seat. Come to the